For Monday, all clubs will return to training. And all AFL clubs will resume full contact training a week later on May 25. Our 2020 AFL Premiership season will resume on Thursday, June 11. All teams will be based out of their home state with the exception of the Western Australian teams, West Coast and Fremantle, and South Australian teams, the Adelaide Crows and Port Adelaide. West Coast Eagles and Fremantle will complete the pre-season training block at their home bases before relocating interstate ahead of their first scheduled match. Current restrictions in South Australia will mean that Adelaide and Port Adelaide will need to relocate interstate before May 25, when full contact training will begin for all 18 clubs.
We are back. Good evening and welcome to Footy SA and WA, all thanks to OTR. Friday is $2 Friday Pie Day at OTR. Scott Waters is alongside me, as always, with a bit of positivity in the air. Scotty, welcome. We're back.
Yeah, Kane, we are. We're back. It's fantastic. And look, some people are saying that this year won't mean as much as others. I don't buy into that. The most professional club in Australia will walk away with the premiership. That's a challenge. Someone's going to win it this year. So I think it's on. It's on for young and old now.
We've been agreeing far too much lately. I'm 100% with you. I don't want to hear there's an asterisk next to this premiership. It's going to be one of the more special premierships that we have ever seen. Let's get straight into the show with the Dometic news headlines. Keep things cool with the Dometic CI42 litre ice box. Let's have a look at how it is going to look, because on Friday, Gillon McLachlan announced that we are back. This is the timeline, May 18. That was today. Training in groups of eight. We saw the footage roll through as all of our clubs returned. Full contact training from next Monday. Port Adelaide and the Crows will be jumping on a plane to the Gold Coast this coming Sunday, which is the 24th, in order to get that full contact training in. Round two starts June 11. Round 2-5 fixture will be released this week, and the remainder of the season will be released in 4-6 week blocks. I did find it funny, some of the restrictions that will be placed on players on game day, Scotty. They're going to be tackling each other, sweating on each other, competing in a physical sport, but they have to sit 1.5 metres away from each other on the bench. No high fives, no song, only 6 people in the coach's box. Come on, are we taking it too far?
Look, there are still some grey areas, we know that. But look, on a positive note, at least we're back up and running. But as I said earlier, I'm fascinated to see what the game now looks like with less coaches, with less preparation. There have been some clubs and some players for a while been saying, look, the pre-seasons are too long. We actually don't need a pre-season to be this long. So we're going to get a look at the game with different supporting structures around it and a slightly different look. Maybe the game looks even better. Time will tell.
The playing conditions will be the same in terms of the length of the game. There will be a bit of extra time between goals and also a bit of an extended quarter time and three-quarter time break, an extra couple of minutes there to disinfect the balls and get the hygiene and all that in place. Now, I saw some vision of the teams back today. It was a bit Mickey Mouse. The players were clearly happy to be back. But if you're a coach, how are you preparing your players now? Because there's only 5, 6, 7 sessions before round one. It's got to be hit the ground running, surely.
Look, firstly, if you've missed the opportunity of the last 4 to 5 weeks, you were already behind. So the really good clubs would have been making sure, whether they were training in 2s or 10s, that they've already been prepared to a point. But now, with minimal amount of time before the real stuff starts again, every second counts. So I would think that, again, that the most organised, mature organisations, it's your West Coasts, it's the sides that are Hawthorne. The Richmonds, the Hawthorns, that have very, very mature coaching structures. They have a massive advantage, and I think they'll take that advantage this year.
Is there any thought that the young group, like the Lions, could recover quicker, shorter breaks, maybe hit the ground running from the start, a bit fresher, or do you think it favours the experienced sides?
I think, look, mentally, it's the side that can get ready earliest, but also it might actually favour a more mature side. I mean, they've had a longer break. Some older bodies might just be, they had that little bit of extra time to come into a season with maybe less niggles as well. So I think it could go either way. But again, I think with a reduction in the coaching ranks, the best group of core coaches that are the most experienced, they've got a huge opportunity now to capitalise.
Fremantle, West Coast, Port Adelaide and the Crows, they're off to the Gold Coast. West Coast and Fremantle are going to share a resort. That one's going to be the Pines Resort. Crows and Port Adelaide to share a resort. Well, Port Adelaide aren't happy. Let's hear from the chairman, David Koch, and coach Ken Hinckley when asked about that today. And then we'll hear from the Crows as well.
We've actually requested not to be in the same hotel.
Have you?
Oh yeah, we have enormous respect for the team, for the Crows. Absolutely enormous respect, but just don't like you. You have to spend 8 weeks in the same hotel, so we've sort of requested to the AFL, why don't you put us with one of the Australian teams?
Our preference as a footy team would be to be on our own. Now, we know there's some constraints that are outside your control, but we are arch enemies a bit. It doesn't make a lot of sense to put them together. We have these great matches and these great grudge matches, and we're going to go into a place and be all buddies. I'm not sure about it. It just doesn't quite feel right in Adelaide.
I don't have an issue with being with Port Adelaide whatsoever. I mean, we crossed the white line, as I think she's on. But I know a lot of our guys, they know each other really well. Sharing a hotel with Port Adelaide, I have no issue. I know a lot of them well. As I said before, when we play that neutral venue and it's a showdown, well, different story.
Two schools of thought here. Port Adelaide are being precious, or they're telling the truth, and why try and hide the secret that these two teams dislike each other? Which side are you on?
Oh, they're telling the truth. There is hatred. I mean, from a West Australian point of view, the hatred between West Coast and Fremantle, it's real. I mean, coaches will always play that down, and, you know, there'll be a cordiality to the way that they talk about it. Well, why don't we bring back Dale Kickett, Phil Reed, Mark Rusciuto, Josh Carr, and have them as chaperones at the hotels? I mean, this will be uncomfortable, and something will happen over that eight-week period.
Yeah. I love it. Let's not hide it, because of dislike for each other. And I reckon there's something with Port Adelaide on the Crows and for their training breach in the Barossa, which may have cost them the fly-in, fly-out exemption. Not sure Port Adelaide looked on the Crows too kindly for that, and that perhaps that cost them as well. But the families will be allowed on the Gold Coast. We know the AFL Players Association fought pretty hard for that. The AFL will fund it. Families will be under pretty strict protocols like the players. If you're a coach, do you allow families there? Because, once again, Adam Simpson has spoken about that. Perhaps they don't come up early. In Port Adelaide today, they want to get accustomed to the facilities for the first couple of weeks before families come up. But it's not an easy one to juggle.
It's not. Oh, look, I don't mind actually allowing the team just to settle in that first fortnight. I think that's get down to business. I mean, their first 2 weeks now are so crucial. So 100% focus on training. But look, a lot of studies show that to get the best performance from an athlete, you've got to make sure that they're holistically looked after. And part of that is their family. Really important, particularly those that have got young kids. They need to have that connection. Otherwise, that isolation factor is going to kick in. So bring the families in once they're settled.
Players are putting their hand up for some pretty strict protocols. They're going to be tested twice a week. There's a lot of things they aren't going to be able to do. They're going to live a much stricter life than the rest of us in society. What they have requested is that this information isn't released to the public. What I don't want to see is the general public dobbing in players. Oh, I saw such and such having a coffee. I saw him sitting a metre too close to his teammate. I saw this, I saw that. The dobbing culture of Australia during this coronavirus pandemic has been disgraceful, and I can certainly understand the players not wanting that information released publicly, because they're putting their hand up to live a very strict, disciplined life. It's not going to be easy. We should cut them a bit of slack when we can.
You're spot on. This is 6 to 8 weeks of being under the microscope. I mean, an AFL player is always under the microscope, but this takes it to another level now with obviously the community pressure. So, look, they're trying to do their best in a very tough situation. We've got to understand that they're human beings as well. Just cut them a little bit of slack.
Cast your minds back to round one. Gillon McLachlan said when we did play, if a player tested positive to coronavirus, the game was off for 14 days. He then extended it to 30 days. But he clarified those comments with the new information, and it's not a given that the game will be suspended if a player contracts coronavirus.
Obviously, it's a hypothetical. It'll depend on the circumstances, when and where they are in a week. You know, they'll be tested in the 24 hours out before any full training or any contact. So they'll only go ahead if there's all negatives. Other than that, they're restricted to groups of 8 players. And so you'll know where they are in the cycle, what the implications are. But broadly, that player will be sat out. And anyone who's had close contact in the 24 hours or 48 hours leading up will determine anyone else who has to be stood down. So then it'll be a question for the doctors about the scale and the implications.
I think that's good to hear. And I think there's some plans in place. There'll be contingencies for it. And it's good to see the game won't be shut down if, in fact, the player does test positive. Also, the players will have to abide by the Queensland anti-vaccination laws, or both of our teams, our four teams, Scotty, will have to get a flu jab, which I wouldn't think is too uncommon. I think when I played, we all got the flu jab. But if you're an anti-vaxxer, you won't be able to play. Do we know of any?
Look, not off the top of my head, but it makes it hard. I mean, obviously, sometimes for religious circumstances, a person will be an anti-vaxxer. So, look, hopefully, for most of them, they're able to get the vaccination and just get on with business. But AFL, how do you rate their performance over 6 to 8 weeks? This has been an incredibly tough journey. I think they've done a reasonable job to get us to this point.
I can't really fault them. It's a good question. I think they've been pretty outstanding. On limited staff, great leadership, they're trying to deal with the Prime Minister, different states of government. We've seen the outspoken clown, Mark McGowan, in Western Australia with his thoughts and his cracks at the AFL. The AFL have bit their tongue. We've seen the issues with South Australia and their tough laws. It's been tough for them. I think they've done a great job. The grand final will be played on October 24th as it sits right now. I hope there will be at least some sort of crowd. And Gillon McLachlan went on 3AW and he didn't rule out some form of crowds by the end of the year.
Where we are today, I think the health officers and the government will say we've beaten expectations. I don't know. I know that it's less likely than likely, but you know, I reckon it's in the hands of the community how well we continue to socially distance and be disciplined as things open up.
Playing in a grand final is one of the great things, and not only do you get the 100,000, the MCG, and celebrating after the concerts and all of that, but you get the grand final parade on the Thursday, you get the open training session where all your fans flock in. It's just one of the best weeks of your life. So I feel for the two teams that do qualify for this year's grand final, and not to have those conditions, it's going to be tough. But I do hope that at least their families and some members and fans get in to see the grand final this year, and it looks like it's a possibility.
Yeah, look, hopefully. But like everyone at the moment, it's a moving feast, isn't it, from week to week? So we'll just see how that unfolds. I mean, even the fixtures might shuffle and change slightly. So they're going to have to still make policy on the run, the AFL.
A disturbing story broke yesterday. Jack Stephen, now Geelong player, four-time best and fairest winner at the Saints, was traded at the end of last year, presented to hospital at 1 a.m. on what would have been Sunday morning with a stab wound to his chest. The details around it are limited, really, Scotty, but I know you coached him and you spoke off-air about just what a great young fella he is, and we're all thinking of him.
Terrific young guy, and I know down at Geelong straight away they loved him, and look, they're going to support him. But look, challenging. He had some really challenging negative influences around him early in his career at St Kilda. The club was able to separate him from some of that. He's had some mental health challenges along the way, which shows you the pressure I think that athletes are under. There's a stat that I saw a couple of days ago, 45% of all athletes have some level of mental anxiety or mental disorder. It's a unique circumstance that our athletes get placed in. Very, very tough. We need to support them as much as we can.
We wish Jack all the best in his recovery from what he's going through. Big show still to come. Stick around. We're going to debunk some myths. What are West Coast, Fremantle, Port Adelaide and the Crows' record away from home? We'll tell you that next. You are watching Footy SA and WA, thanks to our good friends at OTR. OTR takeaway this week. Drop by on OTR this Friday and enjoy a traveller pie or a sausage roll for just $2. Well, the takeaway this week is both of our sides, in fact, all four of them, Scotty, their records away from home. We'll start with West Coast. Clearly a massive advantage in Perth. No surprises there. Plus 25 against their opposition at home. Plus 8 in disposals. Free kicks is always topical, but not as one-sided as we would have thought. But the big one there is they win 77% of their games at home. Interstate, they score 7 less against their opposition and their winning percentage clearly drops. Same with Fremantle there, but their win
That's
percentage
the worry.
Away from
That's
home.
That's the worry for Justin Longmuir.
Disaster.
Look at that. It drops to 20% interstate when they are away from 58%. So a tough start of the year for Justin Longmuir, I think.
I think West Coast are in a good position. Now, I don't necessarily see it as a massive disadvantage for them, because if you look at it this way for West Coast. Look, I think Fremantle are out of the equation in terms of the premiership race, and I think you'd agree. But if West Coast get away with not having to go to Adelaide a couple of times, massive trip there, and not having to fly to play Brisbane in Queensland, a big trip there. So essentially they get those games in a neutral venue. And then the AFL said, well, we might bank you some home games towards the back half of the year. If they can split the first 4 weeks in Queensland, they go 3-1 or, you know, 2-2 and their win loss is 3-2 after 5 and they back in some home games, they're in a great spot.
Oh, I agree. And I also think they've got the maturity to be able to set themselves for that at the start of the year. And look, just climate-wise too, they're coming out of a summer in Perth. They'll go into a summer. Those conditions won't faze them at all. So, look, it's as good as they can make from a bad situation, I think. But early on, you can set yourself up for a premiership tilt this year, without doubt.
Let's look at the South Australian teams and their record at the Adelaide Oval as opposed to away. We'll start with Port Adelaide. They score plus 11, so 11 more points than their opposition at home. Their winning percentage is 58%, drops to an alarming 40% away from home. That's the issue for them. And the Crows, pretty similar, to be honest. I mean, their record at Adelaide Oval hasn't been great in recent times, just a 50% win-loss. But clearly, they're worse off away from home. And like Fremantle, I don't think Adelaide are in the premiership race. They're rebuilding. They've turned over the squad. But Port Adelaide are one of 10 teams, I reckon, that can win it this year. And that's the way they've got to approach this.
Don't you see them as being the more mature side? They're ready to go?
I do. I just think the demographic of their list with the experience and some youth, they've got a lot of players as well in the age range of 24 to 25. A lot will depend on that man, Charlie Dixon. And how fit he can be, and can he hold down, you know, the centre-half forward position and kick, you know, 40, 50 goals for the year. Their reliance on him, but I think they're one of 10 teams that can win it.
And don't underestimate the experience of just Ken Hinckley as well. You've got Matthew Nix coming in as a coach in his first season, and it's just been flipped on its head. Ken has been in that seat for a long time, so that will enable him, I think, to settle that team a lot quicker.
So they'll play at the Gabba and Metricon. Both teams will be requesting a lot of games at Metricon. That's Port Adelaide and the Crows, because they've never lost at Metricon. Wow. There it is. It's an absolute fortress for Adelaide. At Carrara, we used to be the old name they used to call it. Have a look at that. Look at their percentage and their opposition. Gold Coast clearly has lopsided that because they've been a weak side. But they've beaten Richmond, North Melbourne, Melbourne and Brisbane on that ground. And we're going to go back to 2006 when they played Melbourne. So a neutral game. We're going to go back a long way. That man, Brett Burton, kicked 5. But certainly won't be fearful of rocking up and playing on this ground.
Why do you think they've always enjoyed... Because there's been different strengths to the teams that have played there, but why such a strong record?
Not sure. I guess some teams enjoy going up to the warmer climate. It does have that bit of a holiday feel for it. Now, it can be a trap for some young sides, but, you know, an experienced Adelaide outfit like this would have embraced a good time to get away, spend some time by the pool, and they got up on this occasion. Brett Burton fittingly finished with the ball in his hand because he kicked 5. So, as I said, there won't be any demons for the Crows on that ground. They are 11-0. Plenty more coming up on Footy SA. We thank you for staying up late for us. We'll reward you with some more good stuff after this. Thanks to your company on Footy SA and WA. It's all thanks to OTR. It's time now to get into our Kia Great State Moments. That's brought to you by Kia's 7-year warranty. Still the best. Kia offers you value you can trust in Australia's best 7-year warranty across the entire Kia range. Check them out. Outstanding vehicles down there at Kia. Well, Dennis Committee, Western Australian legend, the greatest commentator probably of all time, had some interesting things to say about season 2020 on Perth Radio today.
I can understand all that's going on here, but at the same time, I don't think there should be a premiership or a Brownlow medal. I just feel strongly about that because this is a standalone world event. This isn't over. So playing says more about, I think, Australia's spirit than does a cap or a medal. I think they should just drop the idea of it being a competition because it's so lopsided, so strange. Nobody knows what they're doing in 2 weeks' time. Yeah. So I don't think you can have a real serious competition based on what is pretty flimsy ground.
We love you, Dennis, but we're not going back to the schoolyard unattends where they don't keep score and they just play for a kick and a catch. How would you be telling that to AFL players, Scotty? I vehemently disagree with the great Dennis Committee. let's say you?
I think at this time it's important for the community to have goals and have things that are out there that they can almost take their mind off what's going on. I mean, it has been a tough time for so many different people. Players need things to focus on, but families, the whole ethos behind the AFL and sport in general is about bringing community together. Like, having a proper competition will actually be a very positive distraction for everyone in Australia. So we've got to have a grand final. I'm happy to scrap the Brownlow, though, because it should actually be a national award anyway. I'm not a big rap for the Brownlow.
I don't like the name of it.
I don't think it represents... we're disrespecting the McGarry Medal. We're disrespecting the Sandover. That Brownlow Medal, as great as it has been, is not a reflection of the national comp. I've said this a number of times. It should be a national medal and show respect to all state competitions. But that's my gripe for the night.
Like it. I like a gripe. But it must be said that if we get 17 rounds out plus 4 weeks of finals, I mean, that's enough body of work to have a full season and enough of a sample size to award a premier this year and, in my opinion, a Brownlow medalist. I mean, we've seen some other sports. The NBA have had shortened seasons. MLB baseball have had shortened seasons. It's been shortened seasons across history. We still celebrate the eventual title holders, just as we will do in the future for the winner of the premiership this year. You are watching Footy SA and WA. What are the players been up to on social media? We'll tell you next with our Lumo list. Thanks for staying up late and watching Footy SA and WA. Thanks to OTR. Check them out on Friday because you grab yourself an absolute bargain. $2 Friday Pie Day at OTR. So go in there and sort yourself out. Before we leave tonight, we've got to get through our Lumo Energy SA list, powered by Lumo SA, 100% Australian owned, 1,000% about you. What have the players been up to on social media? Well, they've all been in for their coronavirus tests, Scotty, and it doesn't look that comfortable. Here is Tex filming his teammate, Shane McAdam.
Oh, he's not happy.
I can't watch it. Oh, I can't watch it. Stevie Johnson won the 2007 Norm Smith medalist. What does he call himself at the cafe?
Norm, you've got to be kidding. Norm,
so good.
That is brilliant.
I love the arrogance of that. Sam Powell Pepper lives with Travis Boak. He's got him dancing here. Tricks him in to some dance. These young players.
And again, that's too much time in isolation. Oh,
isn't it? He's got him dancing. Very good. Mitch Brown and his old man, the old spoons trick.
Oldie but a goodie.
Where's he been? How's he not seen this before? The old fake with the mouth?
And it's a fair effort here. That's solid. That is solid.
It's a fair crack.
I've been asking
and Chad Wingard
with all my old Guernseys. Well, this is where they are right now.
Hundreds of playing Guernseys in that bag there. So he's got some Hawthorn and some Port Adelaide ones, clearly. A nice little collection. Before we go, the Australian Football Hall of Fame will hold a dinner where six inductees will be welcomed and a legend. Scotty, some names being thrown around. Carey, Ablett, Dunstall. Split those three for me. Who goes in first?
How do you do that? I mean, Tuck also was another one thrown around. Look, for me, I would go Dunstall because of what he did as a player, what he's done at board level, and also what he's done through the media. I think it's been a more rounded contribution, but they're all legends. They all should be in there at some point.
The great Russell Ebert, for me. Those others can wait. They are young, they can wait. Russell Ebert must be a legend in the Australian Football Hall of Fame. I'm going to leave you on that note. Scotty, thank you.
Thanks, mate.
See you next week on Monday night.